Welcome to Hello Foodservice. In this program, we're looking at waste and sustainability and highlighting just a few of the moves being made in the industry to deal with these vital issues. In the United States, Unilever Food Solutions and the Culinary Institute of America have recently joined forces to help restaurants reduce food waste and create more sustainable operating practices. Unilever is at the forefront of this push worldwide, including here in Australia with its Wise Up on Waste toolkit.
The Wise Up on Waste toolkit that you refer to is one aspect of the whole sustainable living plan. Food service operators traditionally have lots of scope for improvement in reducing waste. It's good for business and also it's good for the planet, as well as that's what the consumers or the diners are also looking for. So all of those aspects get brought together in this Wise Up on Waste toolkit that has been developed. What we are encouraging our salespeople to do is to ask themselves one of three questions. They have to ask themselves whether in any sales call that they are going to make, are they going to help the operator either improve their business efficiency or improve their menu, whether it's differentiation, whether it's make dishes tastier, or whether it's they're going to find some way of improving the guest satisfaction or bring new customers in for that operator. If they can do one of those three things, the call is worthwhile. If not, we're wasting our time and we're wasting the customer's time. So Wise Up on Waste is one which is a toolkit that allows the operator to make their business more efficient. And that is why we think it's good for business. It's a service that we can offer the customers, and it goes beyond selling a box of tea or boosters.
What sort of reaction have you been getting?
It's been a slow start, but we now are at the stage where large organizations from large mine sites to maybe small independent cafes have all sort of bought into the concept. And are using some elements of the toolkit that we provide. Some are using the audit tools, some are using menu planning tools, all of those kinds of things. You can pick and choose what works best for you. And that's the beauty of this, where it's totally flexible. We've done a lot of thought into this on a global scale, because the issues are not unique to Australia. They're quite similar, at least in the developed world, the pattern is the same. In the developing world, it's slightly different, but they also have the same issues. Waste is a topical issue, and we are allowing operators, we're giving them a toolkit, which gives them the flexibility of picking and choosing what makes sense to them.
Some quite interesting research been done over the time, sort of saying, particularly say here in Australia, that consumers are prepared to pay more in a restaurant if they know that their restaurant is actually following the sustainability code.
That's what the research says. So you're absolutely right. It is fascinating. I don't know if it will turn to reality. But when researched, consumers did say that, that they would be willing to pay slightly more for eating in a restaurant that had the right practices in there. I think as long as it's done in moderation, there is some truth to it. But quite often in research, you might say something different to what you might do in reality.
There's also an interesting survey by the National Restaurant Association in the UK, which reveals that in the industry there, 65% of food waste occurs at the preparation stage compared to just 30% on people's plates.
And this is exactly what has gone into the designing of this kit. Both are important, what goes on behind the scenes with food preparation, food storage, what is ordered, how it's stored, all those kinds of things are critical importance. And then also, we cannot say that what is on the plate is of less relevance. 30% of the food that's wasted is still a high volume of food that that gets in thrown into the rubbish. Our belief is that an operator can improve or reduce their food waste by about 20% by putting in some basic good practices. And that's what we are trying to encourage operators to take a look at.
It's positive news that a company like Unilever Food Solutions is leading the way. But it's perhaps even more encouraging to discover that right around the country, small food service operators are playing their part as well. Like the Molly Coddle Cafe in Sydney Stanmore, where owners Peter Hardy and Arthur Ferrer got the local council to agree to locate compost bins nearby.
A lot of people were asking us, what do you do with your waste? Can we take some coffee grounds for our garden and things like that? And so we thought, you know, why don't we do this ourselves? Okay, so we have two bins. Basically, one bin we're maturing and the second bin we are actually filling up at the moment. So we'll always have one closed for about 2 weeks and then one open, which is what we're dumping in at the moment. After the 2 week period and the bin that we're dumping in is full, we will then empty the mature bin and lay it in the sun for about 2 weeks for it to dry out and sort of mature further as we close the other bin off and start filling it up. But we have a mailing list. Also, I'm starting to build a text list at the moment. It's a bit easier. And we just text the local community saying, who wants compost? We've got 10 bags and they tell us and we put their name down and they come and collect it. If you have the ability, I think it's something that doesn't take much time at all. Maybe I spend an hour on the weekend mixing the bins and doing all that sort of thing, and then we spend about 10 minutes walking over and dumping rubbish in the bin. It's not a big process, but the impact that it has on our waste collections and things like that, you know, I don't see why you wouldn't want to. We're doing 3 pickups a week. We're down to 2 pickups for our general waste now, just because of all the organic waste that we are composting.
So what would that be saving you?
Over a year, around about maybe $300 a year, just in waste pickup. Plus you get to see what you're actually wasting, and then you say, oh shit, we just wasted a cauliflower. Why the hell did we buy that cauliflower? You know, and then you start looking at your costs and what you're wasting, and your waste gets cut down as well because you're actually seeing what you're wasting. Okay, well, why are we wasting so much bread? We need to start cutting down on our bread, and we save money that way as well because we're actually seeing what we're wasting. I just think a lot more people should do it. A lot more restaurants and cafes should do it and really sort of open their eyes to what they're wasting and where it's going.
Coming up, what the food service operators of the future are being taught.
Hi, I'm Tim Peterson from Cafe Dove in Sydney's Potts Point. Glad Wrap is one of those must-have products as far as I'm concerned. We use it for a host of tasks. All our bread comes from a wholesale baker, and we wrap it with Glad Wrap to keep it fresher longer. And as we peel oranges ready to make fresh juice, we wrap them in Glad Wrap. It keeps them beautifully fresh until they're ready to use. It's also ideal for storing our vegetables and salads. There are many cling wraps on the market, but for me, Glad Wrap is the best. Made from polyethylene, which doesn't contain BPA and PVC, it's strong, easy to use, and completely safe. No wonder it's Australia's number one food wrap.
Shoyu wa nihon ryori ni oite kakasenai mono desu. 汁やタレの基本となっている調味料は醤油です。醤油は漬け醤油として使われ、刺身の漬け醤油、天ぷらの天つゆなどにも使われます。肉、魚、鶏のマリネの調味料として、炒め物、サラダのドレッシングに塩に代わってシンプルに素材の味を引き出す調味料として、キッコーマン醤油をほんの少し料理に加えてみてください。料理の美味しさが驚くほど広がります。キッコマン、オリジナルトゥザラストドロップ。
While many long-standing food service personnel are having to adapt to the changing times, new industry recruits are fully versed in the sustainability needs of the 21st century.
But here at Wright Campus, we want to put into practice what we preach. Our organisation, the Northern Sydney Institute, is accredited to the environmental standards and we have an environmental management system in place. So we feel it's really important that the students get to experience not only just the learning in the classroom but the environment around them practising those sustainability principles. We have procedures in place that when we're purchasing food, we're trying to make sure that it's as local as possible, it's seasonal and those sorts of things. And of course, all those sorts of purchasing practices not only help with sustainability, but also bring our costs down. So in terms of our recipes and how we buy things, We've just introduced a balcony garden that has a whole lot of herbs and small vegetable crops in it. But we're also in the process of building a very large kitchen garden that we will be able to grow very large crops that we will also be able to use in the kitchen. So whether it's the way we purchase food or the way we grow food, we try and put those sustainability principles in place.
Because this college is unique in this country, isn't it?
Yes, it is the largest hospitality training organisation, training institute in this country. We have 16 commercial kitchens that have around 15 students in them, anything up to three times a day. So you can imagine we purchase an awful lot of food here to be able to train students on, you know, to cook the food up. So then we've got to be very aware of how we manage the waste from all that food, because despite our best efforts, there will always be some waste. But again, in the cycle, we try to minimise the amount of food that we are cooking. We then, any scraps left from that, we either reuse, such as in our stocks and so forth. We have a pulp master, which takes all the food scraps away, particularly the meats and things that aren't so great for composting. We put all our meats into a pulp master that then gets taken away and created biofuel. We regularly get reports on how much waste we're taking out of the system by putting our food scraps through the pulp master. But then any green waste, we're able to compost because of our horticulture students here. We have very large areas and very large composting bins. So we're also able to compost a lot of our green waste, and that goes then gets used around the grounds to beautify the grounds and make help the gardens and so forth.
Talk us through the ordering here, because it's a very, very refined process, isn't it?
Yes, well, our chefs put their recipes together several weeks, months in advance, and they are sent down here to where they're all entered into our HiMax system. And what that does is let us know exactly the quantities we need to purchase for each week. And then the deliveries come in. We're in a very large stores area here. And as food's prepared for each class, the stores officers, you can see in the background here, take the printouts of what's required for each of the classes. They bag up all the produce and meats and past stock that's required and put it in containers. So for each class, what we have ready is all the produce that they need goes up to the classrooms. Of course, if a student doesn't turn up and we've got some excess up there, we also have systems in place that very quickly we identify that we might have too much up there because there's a student away, and that food will be brought back down here and safely reused for other classes and so forth. So.
And we're talking about almost down to the last half tomato, aren't we?
Yes, we are. We are. We try to reduce as much as possible, first of all, our purchasing. And then if we do have excess stock, we either reuse it for other classes and then reduce our purchasing the following week. Or alternatively, if it's getting to a point where we don't see that we can use it, we'll sell it up in our shop.
From your experience, how do you think the food service industry in general is coping with the whole issue of sustainability and waste?
Look, I think with anything, there's always carrots and sticks. And I think at the moment, what's driving a lot of us, including us, is the increased costs of waste and electricity and water and gas and so forth. So certainly, I'm not saying this because we just want to be good, we do want to be good model citizens, but you know, there's also good reasons for doing this. And as the price of waste increases and the price of electricity and water and so forth, a lot of these practices help the business's bottom lines. Some of our restaurants that we train staff for, example I could use is the Rockpool Group. They've certainly made, they've got wonderful kitchens that have induction stoves in there that certainly saves on electricity and heating of the kitchens and so forth. So you see many of the big, large restaurant organisations really embracing this and putting great systems in place to make sure that they reduce their footprint on on the environment.
Hi, welcome to William Manglis Institute. My name's Nicole Coran, I'm a patisserie teacher here. What we're going to do today is show you around the Institute and some of our sustainability initiatives that we have here. Well, our push here for sustainability at William Manglis starts here on the roof by installing these solar panels. Behind me here is a landscaped area, and beneath that, which was done about 3 years ago, we've installed a 40,000 litre water tank. So what we have here is an Australian native mint that we've planted out last year. So this is our first project, and eventually we're going to start moving that through all our beds. So students just come by here and pick what they want and then put that into their dishes. What we're trying to establish throughout the kitchens here is a recycling system. So what we have is our general waste bin. We also have our co-mingled recycling bin. And then we also have our food bin. So we're walking through into our building D, and what we have here is our bakery cafe where all our produce gets sent to the cafe so nothing gets wasted in the Institute. And what we've introduced this year is a keep cup for all our staff and students to purchase. And so all they do is then bring that into the cafe whenever they want a coffee and use a refillable cup all the time. So what we have here is our courtyard. In the planning stage, hopefully by next year, we're going to put it all in a native edible garden. We'll be using rainwater here, so we'll be collecting rainwater off the roofs. Our other initiative to get started is our own honey. So on our building D, we're going to hopefully install 1 to 2 hives. These days, particularly in this era, we need to really consider sustainability. There's a huge waste, it always has been in the industry, and the idea of continuing that waste over the years is really unsustainable. So what we do have to do is really try and encourage a change, and the change comes in education.
How interested are the students in pursuing this?
Some come in with a great knowledge already and some don't come with any at all. And what's really wonderful to see is that those students that don't have much knowledge is then finding out about the damage that they're causing, and then realising what they can do to manage that and change that situation. So they find it really inspiring to learn.
And when they go out and get jobs, obviously they're taking a new message to the people that they're employing them.
Of course, yeah, of course. And so it's all about changing the industry and changing the ways people are doing that. And so trying to get students to have the courage to go into industry and bring those new ideas, concepts into industry.
And how receptive are the employers to that?
There might be some employers that really find it hard to change, but once we find that some students come back to us and say, once we let employers know that they, by changing, they're also saving money and costs, you find a lot of employers are on board to that.
Next, the executive chef with a duo message.
That's Otway Fork you're cooking, so don't bugger it up.
No, chef.
I always say, for tender, juicy, tasty pork, it has to be Australian, and it has to be bred free range. And that's Otway Pork. Reared in Victoria and South Australia, the sows roam free in paddocks with mud baths and shelter in purpose-built huts. So if you want to serve pork from Aussie Pig, make sure it's Otway. So when you cook it, don't bugger it up. It's Australian.
We have a saying here, every time you open a Birchon Way product, you're lifting the lid on something special. You are also lifting the lid on 30 years of experience. There were just 3 people when this company started in 1980. We've grown a lot since then, but we've never lost sight of the original philosophy. To produce the highest quality products in Australia, using Australian ingredients wherever possible. Food service professionals know and love our whole egg mayonnaise and our aioli garlic. They're a kitchen staple for many. And over the decades, the range has grown to include dressings and condiments. They are made fresh with the finest ingredients and with real artisan passion. And you can't beat that. It's what makes the Birch and Wade difference.
At Melbourne and Olympic Parks, Marcus Werner, executive chef with Delaware North, is responsible for serving tens of thousands of meals a year at the Function Centre, the Rod Laver Arena and the Hisense Arena, and making sure there's as little waste as possible in the process.
I think the most important is you have a smart menu design. How we're doing it is we're using a premium cut and also a secondary cut of meat and combining it in one dish. We're calling it a duo. So the secondary cut will be maybe a braised ox cheek. We're braising it for 5 hours, very slow, cooked in for different spices, and then adding a premium cut like a fillet maybe, or a nice Angus sirloin, and then combine these two ingredients on one plate. First of all, we give the customers value for money, two different cuts of meat. Secondly, we cut our cost by half.
How do your customers react when you suggest this sort of thing?
In general, very open, because you give them the option of two items on one plate. So it's value for money. Really, we're spending a lot of time and effort to make something out of secondary cuts, and then also we have the premium, because they always say like, oh, if we're just calling it braised meat, it not sound very premium. We want to give value for money to our client. But if you always say the duo, like a premium product, we have the Angus premium fillet plus the braised one, then they're very open for it. And actually afterwards, the comments from the guests to the clients are fantastic. So the second time around, so it will be much easier. They go like, yeah, we go with the Jews again, Jew of lamb or whatever you can suggest it for us. It's fantastic.
Because you're dealing here at Rod Laver Arena with such large numbers, I suppose some chefs watching this will say, well, that's all very well for him to say because he's dealing in big numbers. What happens in a much smaller operation, a small restaurant, for example?
I think it's for any size. We're all dealing with difficulties with food costs going up, 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 but probably the owners want to go down, down, down. So it's working in a small restaurant as much, especially because the secondary cuts, you're normally cooking it anyway sous vide, so it means you're cooking it in a cryo bag, so you have portion control. I would say it probably will work for a small restaurant even better.
Now, you're European trained, and many of your compatriots here are European trained. Yeah. Do you think you have a different attitude towards this style of cooking than, say, an Australian trained chef?
Yeah, I think probably because our training is more, we're starting from the basis. So the first thing you're doing is using your stocks, your sources, you're using a lot of secondary cuts, and learn how to braising it and how to roasting it and what to do with all these things. I think the taste in Europe is we're using a lot of ox tongue or livers or hearts, where years back, nobody knew what to do with it, so everybody gave it to dogs or gave it to the staff. Where in Europe, it's a challenge, and I think the chefs really probably more proud of what they can do out of the secondary cuts than what you can get off the barbecue.
And do you think it's something that it has to be driven from the top, from the executive chef level? It's almost like an individual passion, and you have to drive it.
Guarantee it has to be driven by every individual chef, because you have to then educate or indicate all the customers, the clients, because as soon your clients are asking for organic products, asking for sustainable products, as better the market's gonna be. And as more we driving it and we educating our clients, our customer, and more the producer will change.
In a moment, the simple cleaning system with a growing list of food service devotees.
Not only do we use it in dashi and our soy jellies and marinating our fish, we also use curcumin soy sauce for making vinaigrettes or dressings. Curcumin soy sauce is not only meant for fine dining, it can be used across the whole food service industry. We should try to replace salt with the soy sauce, and this will give you a depth of umami into your food that is unsurpassed.
As head chef of Burnt Orange, an upmarket cafe and retail outlet overlooking Sydney Harbour, Blair Peterson places great emphasis on using the best products for the job, which is why he chooses Chucks.
As a chef, I think it's very important that we do our bit to protect the environment.
The new Chucks range of biodegradable cloths, super wipes, and a non-scratch scourer tick that box. Made from 100% natural recycled fibres, Chuck's super strong absorbent cloths can hold up to 12 times their own weight, are machine washable and completely biodegradable.
In the kitchen, these are great for cleaning up all the big spills.
The Chuck's fully biodegradable super wipes have the familiar double action holes. These easily pick up dirt and grime and can be rinsed over and over.
The super wipes are the kitchen bees, the real workhorses. When they're finished, they go straight into the compost bin.
Made from 100% natural biodegradable cellulose fibres, the Chuck's non-scratch scourer sponges are safe for non-stick cookware and remove tough marks and grease without scratching.
In the kitchen, we go through sponge scourers every couple of days. These new ones are so much more durable and a lot longer lasting.
Even the new range Chuck's packaging is environmentally friendly. The scourer pads break down after being exposed to the environment, and the inks used are soy-based. And doing the right thing by the environment doesn't cost more. These are premium products without a premium price tag.
I'm really impressed with the new range. They're doing a great job and we're doing our bit for the environment. And you can't ask better than that.
Doing the right thing by the environment is all part of the waste and sustainability issue in food service. And e-water is finally beginning to make its presence felt. Many were sceptical to start with, but now it's gaining real momentum. So what is e-water?
It is very similar to a saltwater pool system. It works using just plain table salt, electricity and tap water. It takes the brine made from the table salt and pulls apart through the electrolytic process the sodium and chloride, and that makes an alkaline solution and an acidic solution. The alkaline solution is made for cleaning, to replace most cleaning chemicals, and the acidic or sanitising side is a replacement for other food sanitisers and surface disinfectants, etc.
So how can you use it in a kitchen?
Various ways. Oftentimes it's in a fixed position above sinks for preparation of food, so it's used for sanitising leafy vegetables, for meats, for fish, for herbs, fruits, etc. It's also used to fill spray bottles that are then used to clean and sanitise stainless steel surfaces and benches and cutting boards and knives and the like. And with spray bottles, of course, you can leave the back of house situation and use those spray bottles to clean front of house, tables and chairs and glass, display cabinets, mirrors, etc. In the larger systems that are tanked and reticulated, it's used in many of our sites now for hand washing applications.
What sort of reaction do you get from chefs when you come in and talk about this?
Originally, it was a high level of scepticism amongst the majority of people, really. Although the chefs that have initially embraced e-water, and I'm going back here, 3 and 4 years ago, tend to be those that are respected for their forward thinking and their creativity. People like Shannon Bennett, for example, very early adopter of e-water technology, is usually regarded in that way. He sees and others see e-water as part of a program for delivering a more sustainable kitchen, more sustainable food, and that seems to be a trend that is gaining momentum. And as it does so, chefs are much more tuned into e-water and the fact that it offers an option to package chemical.
Cost is the big thing though, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. It depends on the size of the system. Ultimately, it comes down to, in most cases, to a payback period. And we've been able to monitor that, and it's been researched pretty thoroughly by both clients and universities, in particular MIT. About payback periods, and we find they're generally under 3 years, sometimes even less than 2 years. But if the capital investment isn't utilised properly, of course that could be a longer period of time. So it's a lot to do with putting a system in place, ensuring good training, and that the operators are maximising the utility of the system to do as much as they can with it.
Somebody watching this right now saying, well, I've got a very small place, it's too small to do this. Is there a place too small to use it?
We are in a 16-seat Japanese restaurant. We're in a cafe part of the Yost group in Melbourne called Silo, which probably has 12 seats. But such is the importance to those folk of not having chemicals near their food, that investment is seen as, you know, paramount to delivering the quality product that they want to. So in answer to your question, it depends on what, you know, the heartbeat is like of the person that's making a decision about the product. I don't see myself as a tree-hugging kind of evangelist, but the logic of having a system like this on site, which is your own plant, puts you as an operator in control. There is obviously less impact on the environment because you're not relying on factory-produced chemical that's transported with all the carbon emissions and all the rest of it in packages that then have to be treated somehow, landfill, recycled, whatever it might be. And of course, there's trade waste issues with many packaged chemicals that, you know, it's the bubbly creek syndrome that I'm talking about. So if you have a system on site that does the job of sanitising and cleaning without needing that kind of wasteful, non-sustainable product, then it's, to me, got to be a good thing.
Got to be good indeed. And if you'd like to find out more about eWater, here's the website. We've touched on just a few issues in this vitally important topic, so if you have a story to tell, let us know. And in the meantime, if you found this program interesting, please pass the link on to your friends and colleagues. Thanks for watching. We'll be back with another mainstream food service issue in the next few weeks.